on behalf of Tata Institute of Social Sciences and the Department of Education, Mumbai University, I welcome all of you for this webinar. It's going to be a very long series for almost 2 months. And as Mythili just now mentioned, the times are very difficult. However, as academician, as teacher educators, we need to carry on with our work, not only carry on with our work, but also provide opportunities for the field of teacher education to move ahead and join the entire world in taking ahead teacher education. As we all know, there is a paradigm shifting. Where the emphasis has shifted from teaching to learning. Recently in one university, there was a lot of complaint from some students, and therefore an inquiry committee was set up against the teacher. The students said the teacher is not teaching, not giving us any material. And in the inquiry committee, to the shock of the members, the teacher against whom the complaint was lodged said, the government doesn't pay me for teaching. So everyone, including the inquiry committee members, were shocked. Then the lady said, let me finish, I have not yet finished. Then she said, the government is not giving me salary for teaching. The government is giving me salary for ensuring that learning takes place. And therefore, I do not give notes to students, but I involve them in a lot of activities so that they learn. So this is the point now. There are many of us who have realized that we need to ensure that learning takes place rather than quotes completing the syllabus. Often we hear that people blame teachers for anything that goes wrong. Partially, this may be true because we need to bring a lot of changes. People also feel that we are very slow in adapting to the changes at the international level. We have a lot of difficulties. Most of the models of teaching and the approaches to teaching we have borrowed from the West, where class size is very small. Often the class size is about 15 students or 20 students. And that may not be suitable to the Indian conditions, because in many cases in India, the class size is very large. So what we need in teacher education is to understand how to gear our teaching to suit the international conditions, number one. At the same time, we need to develop our own pedagogies and andragogies that suit our local conditions, where class size is very huge, almost 7 to 8 times what we find in the developed countries. So this is a very big challenge that faces us. It requires a lot of research into how to bring about changes in teaching learning methods or modify those models that have been provided by the Western developed advanced countries. National Policy 2020 has suggested many changes. Though I do not personally fully agree with some of the changes. However, we need to gear our teaching and professional development towards this national policy on education. It has a separate chapter on teacher education, and we need to adapt our teaching learning styles to suit that. We may have university departments which will provide a bachelor's degree in education as well as master's degree in education. It will also be a very big center from which in-service education program for teachers would be provided in the new education policies. Though right now it is in the draft form, it has not been implemented, but soon it may be implemented. We also, some of the good institutions, teacher education institutions, be it colleges, are focusing on international education, because the international schools find that our teacher preparation is not up to the mark that they expect. And therefore, when a teacher joins an international school, the teacher has to undergo training again, training in teaching, training in evaluation, and training in management, and so on. And looking at this, many of the B.Ed. colleges have taken up this matter and they have included international education in their curriculum. Personally, and if you look at the overall situation in India, a large section is below poverty. We also need to look at them as teacher educators, and therefore we also need to create one course only for the disadvantaged sections and keeping in mind inclusive pedagogy or keeping in mind transformative pedagogy and so on. This is lacking in most of the universities, I strongly feel. And therefore, I feel that we need to bring about tremendous changes in our curricula and various other aspects of the curriculum, including the core courses like philosophy of education, psychology of education, sociology of education, and some of the other aspects also like curriculum studies, management of education, economics, politics, and sociology of education, and so on. And I think this two months program, I'm sure it will help all of you. It will give a direction to new syllabi, the new curricula, and also it will give a focus to research vis-a-vis curriculum of teacher education. I congratulate Dr. Maithili and her team for this particular program originated from TISS. So I congratulate both of them. And of course, the department is always with them. Earlier also, we had a round table with TISS, and it was a very fruitful exercise where we tried to make recommendations to NCT. And I think this particular program also, if we can come out with some kind of a monograph for this, it would be a very nice proposition for teacher education. Thank you. And I once again welcome all of you for this webinar. And I'm sure it is going to be very fruitful for all of us. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Professor Pandya, for that warm welcome and very succinct introduction to the webinar series. So basically, as Dr. Pandya pointed out, this is going to be a weekly webinar series, primarily for M.Ed. students and some of their faculty. And we will have it every day between 11 a.m. and every Tuesday between 11 a.m. and 12 p.m. And next Tuesday, we have Dr. Kamala Mukunda, who would be taking the session on cognitive learning and development. We will share the readings with you all within this week. So you have some time to come prepared for the session. I have a few questions before we begin. Unfortunately, the screen share is still not able to resume. Primarily, the objective of this particular session is to introduce the theoretical representations of teacher education, pre-service teacher education in the Indian context from a historical and social perspective. So this will be done in very broad strokes. And then teacher preparation for the 21st century. So here again, we have chosen Darling Hammond's paper to shape the current discourse on teacher education programs. There are many other ideas. We have chosen this more as a representative since she has studied teacher education programs across the globe and has researched the sector extensively. This is only to give us an indication of the complexities in teacher preparation. These are the broad objectives of this particular session. Let me begin with a question for all of you. What do you think are the key roles of teachers? You could either key in the chat box or unmute yourself and share your idea. The key roles of teachers, according to you.
Uh,
They should understand their students firstly, and accordingly they will implement all the teaching methods.
No, Ananya, please stay in the questions. Yeah, thank you. Anybody else?
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning.
Ma'am, in my view, role of the teacher today has drastically changed, and she is more of a facilitator, a nurturer, he or she is responsible for most of the socio-emotional learning as well of the child. So not only academics, but all-round development, especially in terms of socio-emotional learning is something that she plays a pivotal role in. Thank you.
Thank you very much. So basically, when you are saying the role has changed, so the assumption is earlier the role of a teacher was to impart knowledge, and now it is expanded to other domains of a child's life and development as well.
Yes, ma'am.
So how do you think these roles get formulated? So when you say it has shifted from a certain role to a different role, what causes these shifts?
Ma'am, these shifts are caused due to changes that happen globally in terms of lifestyle, in terms of growth of a nation. Say, for example, the digital and technological advancements have led us to learn. This digital platform has been utilized for teaching and learning, though it is something that we are doing now in India, but across the globe, it's happening for the longest time, I guess. So it's the changing needs of the society that lead us to the changes, that lead to the changes in the role of the teacher.
Thank you very much for that.
Mathily, do you want me to read the messages?
Some of them, please, if you don't mind.
Okay. So people had responded to your first question about what are the key roles of teachers, according to you. So people have responded, guide, facilitator, teachers are the pillar of society, collaborator, mentor, modifier, facilitator, and a guide. Provide them an open environment to learn their own experience, facilitate learning, cultural, learner first, so on. So many of the responses include facilitator, guide, mentor, nurturer. Something is also written that a teacher should be a learner first and then a teacher.
Yeah, those are a range of responses. Thank you all very much for that. How do you think teachers get prepared for these roles? That's right. Social dynamics, the politics, historical circumstances, commercial needs. All of these dictate what a teacher can and cannot do. Now, I would like you to share, how do you think teachers get prepared for these roles?
By getting them know about how to implement their skills during their pre-service. Teacher training.
Yes, teacher preparation is one means wherein they can get to meet goals. What else? What are the other means?
Their personal experiences day to day while in service.
Absolutely. Personal experiences also matters, and their own life history.
Hello, ma'am.
Yes, please go ahead.
Hello. Hello, ma'am. By updating herself with the changing situation.
That's right. So while personal histories and experiences shape a teacher's roles, it is equally important that the teacher is able to respond to the roles that the society and the profession ascribes to her. And that happens through the teacher preparation program and continuous upgradation, as many of you are putting out. So basically, if we look at the role of teachers in terms of who decides, it could be the some of the educational thinkers, both past and present. The policies shape the role of teachers, as many of you had pointed out. Political and socio-cultural exigencies, market forces, all of these have an impact. And current discourses, many of you also had pointed out how global discourses also impact what teachers learn and do within classrooms. And it has a bearing on how they are taught and how they are assessed. Primarily, we are going to be using Hugh Socket's models of teacher education as a framework to make sense of the different models and approaches to teacher preparation program across the world. And he emphasizes the epistemic role and the moral role that teachers epistemic role basically implies knowing the school subject matter, knowing the students, and knowing the context, as again many of you had pointed out. And this is a quote from Ivar Goodson, who has extensively studied teachers' lives. His book is very interesting for those of you who are interested in reading narratives about teachers' lives. And in terms of moral roles, a teacher has a responsibility towards the learners, towards society, towards her own professional community as a member of the teaching profession, as well as the institution that has appointed her. So as I told you, Hugh Socket is one way in which we can try and make sense. There are multiple approaches to it as well. So he classifies models of teacher preparation as the scholar professional, whose primary emphasis is on knowledge and knowing, the nurturer professional, wherein the teacher education programs focus on an individual's development, the clinician professional basically emphasizes building up adaptive expertise in teachers, because the contexts in which teachers teach are extremely complex, and no one teacher preparation program can ever hope to prepare teachers for all the complexities. And the needs of students are also extremely diverse. So clinician professional emphasizes on developing adaptive expertise among teachers, primarily using educational research as the knowledge base. Then the fourth model is the moral agent professional, with a moral focus, wherein people who design these kinds of programs emphasize on integrating the academic content with the intellectual and moral virtues that need to be developed. Again, Hugh Socket himself points out that these are not exclusive buckets in that sense, and there are overlaps across these models. Now, when we come to the National Curriculum Framework for Teacher Education that NCTE brought out, expectations about the roles of teachers are listed as given in this slide. This is from pages 20 and 21 of the NCTE document. will have both these screens for a couple of seconds so you can read them up. Teachers must care for children and love to be with them. Understand children within social, cultural, and political contexts. Be receptive and be constantly learning. View learning as a search for meaning out of personal experiences and knowledge generation as a continuously evolving process of reflective learning. View knowledge not as an external reality embedded in textbooks, but as constructed in the shared context of teaching, learning, and personal experience. Own responsibility towards society and work towards building a better world. Appreciate the potential of productive work and hands-on experience as a pedagogic medium, both inside and outside classroom. Analyze the curriculum framework, policy implications, and texts. So these are some of the roles of NCF, of teachers that NCFTE has laid down. What are the four models do you think NCFTE subscribes to? The four models that Hugh Thorpe has described. Any guesses from anybody?
I think the nurturing and the professional.
Nurturer professional seems to be a model that NCFTE subscribes to.
Ma'am?
Yes, please. Please go ahead.
According to NCF, I think a student role is going to be the knowledge constructor and the teacher's role is to facilitate in that construction and just to engage them in such an environment where they can construct themselves. Thank you.
Absolutely right. So if you look at the vision of NCFTE, it is to develop humane and reflective teachers. So it could fall under nurturer professional and also a moral agent professional as well. So moving on to the second segment of the presentation. Again, as I told you, in very, very broad brushstroke, we will look at how teacher education in India has evolved till the present time. So as you all know, it was a colonial legacy that we were left with, and the structures of the colonial legacy continues for till the present time impact. From independence till the 1990 program of action based on the 1986 education policy, government committees as well as policies have been trying to focus on expanding the role of teachers and more importantly, providing teachers with a professional status. Improving the professional status of teachers and their working conditions. That was the primary focus of many of these committees. And all of them, right from the first education policy onwards, have recognized the key role that teachers play in shaping the society and the country. National Council of Teacher Education was established as a statutory body in 1995 by an Act of Parliament in 1993. Prior to that, from 1973 onwards, it has existed as an advisory body to the government on teacher education. Then in 2012, as you all are aware, we had the Justice Burma Committee on Teacher Education. This was set up as a result of a litigation filed in the Supreme Court. And currently, the draft National Education Policy, as well as Dr. Pandya has pointed out, has an exclusive chapter on teacher education. So moving on to teacher education for the first century. Again, as I told you earlier, we are considering Darling-Hammond as one exemplar to look at how teacher preparation program is being conceptualized in the current context. So Darling-Hammond says that programs should be of longer duration and it should incorporate rigor. And she posits three interlocking ideas in terms of designing a teacher education program. So firstly, she says the curriculum has to be coherent and there has to be integration among the courses, all the courses themselves, and the coursework and the field work in school, she calls it as the clinical work. So she ascribes the field placement, the practice in teaching and internship in schools similar to the clinical practice in medical profession. That's why she calls it the clinical work in school. The second factor that she says is important is to engage with supervised school-based work, which is integrated along with the coursework, primarily the pedagogy courses, thereby linking theory and practice. The third point that she makes is that it's important for teacher education institutions and departments of education to work closely with schools and develop a positive synergy with the schools. So schools should not be spaces where students are just placed for practice teaching and internship, but the relationship has to be nurtured strongly and in a synergistic manner. So let's listen to Professor Darling-Hammond briefly. Oh, sorry about that.
Sought to hire less well-educated teachers who would work for lower wages and who would go along with the regime of prescribed lessons and pacing schedules without protest. In a book widely used for teacher training at that time, the need for unquestioned obedience was stressed as the first rule of efficient service for teachers. We are still having this debate, or as Dana might put it, we are having a war that continues on and that is really partly because of the struggle between a practical conception of teaching as the work of bureaucrats and a professional conception of teaching as the work of people who are well-informed about learning and development and about how to effectively use strategies to support young people in actualizing their potential.
Basically, what Professor Linda Darling-Hammond is saying here is that the debate between the factory model of education and teacher preparation for that and the professional model of teacher preparation is more than 100 years old in the context of the United States. And those debates are still continuing. The point that two points that she's making basically is that there is an assumption that lesser preparation, which again translates to lower wages, but then that gives rise to poor status of the profession. And a certain strand of thinking promotes obedience rather than agency. So what is valued in teacher preparation is obedience instead of independent agency where a teacher can act independently on her own to transform the education system. So that is the main point that Darling Hammond is making in this short clip. So the current discourses on learning basically stem from premises of learning that learning itself is development. So learning is not something as a result of development. And that we construct understandings of the world around us, which will require an active engagement of our minds. More importantly, errors are basically essential steps to forge understanding. So errors are not something that should be avoided. And reflections and abstractions, where we are able to abstract ideas and concepts from the concrete experiences that we have, as being crucial for learning. And another point that is stressed in the current periods is that of a community of practice. As you all pointed out in the beginning, it is essential for a teacher to have academic support throughout her teaching career. And for that, the best way of providing such support is through vibrant communities of practice where teachers can dialogue with each other. So the NCF 2005 broadly takes on from these ideas of learning. And I will not go into the details of the learning theory, which will be done in the next session. If we look at the current discourses on teaching, so there is a broad agreement that teaching is a complex and cognitive task that involves elements of craft, technical competence, as well as it has a rigorous empirical base in the form of research of teaching and learning processes. Yes, along with communities of practice, development centers are also a crucial site for teacher continuous development of teachers. So this being the case, where there is a certain conception of learning and a certain conception of teaching, how can teacher education programs prepare teachers to don the roles of teachers as envisaged by NCFTE and taking into consideration our current understanding of learning and teaching? I know I have the wheel of think is larger than the other wheels, because I do feel that teaching is a cognitive task and it involves a lot of thinking. But that wheel cannot move smoothly without the affect part and as well as the action part. So think, feel, and act basically are intricately linked together. So in terms of equipping a teacher to think professionally in the current context, so it requires a deep understanding of the subject content, inclusive pedagogies and assessment strategies, so as to be able to reach out to the diverse needs of children, including children with disabilities, and an understanding of how children grow and learn that is grounded in current research and discourses, an understanding of how culture and language influence learning, classroom organization principles, curriculum and development and its principles. Although teachers in our country are not directly involved in curriculum development, an understanding of how this is designed, a critical understanding is essential. And then of course, the broad aims and purposes of schooling as well. As someone pointed out in the chat earlier, that philosophy of education forms the core for teacher preparation. So when it comes to the affect component, a teacher has to learn to engage with her own emotions as well as with that of the learners. So in the current circumstances, when she herself is facing a lot of uncertainty and confusion, she is still expected to reach out to learners and put them at ease. Teachers need to have the dispositions to be able to participate and seek such participation actively on their own in professional development programs like many of you have done today. And a teacher must be able to forge a professional identity for herself or himself in relation with the policy makers, with the school heads, with the parents, with colleagues, school or institution heads, if you're working in a teacher education institution. And of course, the larger community as well. And in terms of practice, teachers need to have a repertoire of skills, strategies, and routines that she is able to put in place in the classroom. Be it a teacher education, pre-service teacher education classroom, a BEd classroom, or a school classroom. And importantly, a teacher should be able to make judgments about what to do and when to do a particular action. And judgments, as philosophers will tell you, is a delicate balance between our own inherent and tacit understanding and some deliberative understanding that comes from our preparation as a professional teacher.
Hello.
What does the short video clip communicate to you? Yes, one of you. Certainly commotion.
Hello.
Yes, please.
No engagement.
But what is the context of this engagement?
It looks like a video of current scenario where everybody is getting involved with online learning.
Exactly. So this is an online learning scenario. All right. Yes, this is certainly an online teaching where a teacher is struggling to hold the attention of the students. Not necessarily one-way communication, because we do see the video snippets of the other students as well, and we do hear students. Yes, you can judge one of the students' behavior as, we don't know if it is a classroom situation. Participant is the right word, you're right. You can judge that as inhuman. Anything else? Actually, this is a student hacking of online classes and presenting it in the social media. We don't know if it is unorganized online learning. The teacher may have planned it quite effectively. Lack of emotional connect is certainly an issue there, which can be addressed in a face-to-face classroom context. Perhaps the formal setup of a physical classroom ensures that everyone behaves in a certain way and the decorum is maintained, which is lost in an online context when you are logging in from the home. That is certainly an issue. And we could perhaps guess that the teacher wants to teach, but the students are not ready to engage with him, and certainly a lack of interest and seriousness on the part of students. So this is clearly a beleaguered teacher in the present time. So I'm going to pose these questions back to you again to think in terms of what is expected of teachers during this lockdown period itself. And see, no teacher preparation program could have foreseen such a lockdown situation ever. I mean, this could have been stuff of science fiction, certainly, but definitely not in a teacher curriculum program. So what aspect of their preparation do you think could have equipped teachers to play this part? And what are the implications of pedagogy for teacher education within the framework of active and learner-centered approaches that we briefly discussed here, and which both the NCF 2005 as well as NCFTE 2009 elaborates considerably? And how can a teacher education program prepare teachers to meet the needs of inclusion and equity, especially in the current times when the option of online engagement is not available to a large sections of our population? So how do teachers reach out to such students? So I'm going to leave you with these questions to ponder on. And please do engage with them with your faculty in the colleges over email or other means. And I'm also going to leave you with two tasks. One is to write a reflective narrative of your own pre-service experience and reflect on some of these questions that were shared in the previous slide. And also brainstorm on ideas for supporting children in difficult circumstances. How can you, as a practicing teacher educator or a student teacher who is preparing to become a teacher educator, how can you support children directly or through teachers in helping them learn during this lockdown period? So still there is no clarity in terms of when schools can commence. Some say it is going to be in July. Some, there are conflicting reports on this as of now. In different parts of the country, again, it's going to be different. So you can take a look at some of these references when we share the presentation with you. So we have, I'm making good time. So we have 5 minutes for your quick feedback and reflections on the sessions. So these tasks and questions, you are free to share it with us in the group. But if not, please do share it amongst yourselves, among your colleagues and friends within your institutions. I open it up to quick questions, comments.
Ma'am, can I share something?
Please do, please go ahead.
I'm a teacher basically from last 20 years. And this situation we never faced any time in my life. Now we have a group of children who are sitting at home, and we have a schedule for teachers to take online classes for them through Zoom and different other apps, 3 hours in a day, specifically standard 8th, 9th, 10th, every day, Monday to Saturday, 3 hours a day. And we are making the time schedule for them, and children are also sitting with the teachers online through completing their works, and they submit their work by mail or maybe by WhatsApp and different other way. Like we have created Google worksheet, Google Classroom for them to submitting their work. We are taking some other help of service provider like Khan Academy and all. This is for grade 8 to 10th, and grade 1 to 7, we are organizing 3 days in a week 2-hour session with the different subject teachers online. So at the time of lockdown, they can sit at home and do some productive work, which can continue their curriculum for better and not to help for something and not to get stuck.
Thank you very much for sharing this experience. You have brought out an important point specifically in terms of how teachers are able to respond to the situation on the go. As I told you earlier, no amount of prior preparation would have prepared any of us for this kind of a situation.
Agreed.
Some of you are asking for practical hands-on learning in the current situation. I would guide you to a number of websites that are available currently that are providing excellent ideas for teachers, children, and parents to engage children. There is a small component within the TISS website also specific to pedagogy subjects of secondary schools. So those of you who are interested can take a look at that as well. All right. So thank you all very much for coming in such large numbers. We had in fact planned to keep the number within 50, but going by the enthusiastic response, we didn't want to deprive any of you who had registered from attending this webinar. I do hope it was useful. Thank you all for your very kind and generous words of encouragement. So this definitely gives us the impetus to go further for the next 2 months. I thank Professor Pandya and Dr. Sybil Thomas, Department of Education, University of Mumbai, for their constant support in these kinds of academic endeavors between TISS and University of Mumbai. I thank our chairperson, Professor Padma Sarangpani, for her support and encouragement in all these initiatives, and all my colleagues at the center. And we will share this presentation along with the video links with all of you. I hope you've received the readings for this week session. We will share the readings for the next week session, which will be taken by Dr. Kamala Mukunda from the Center for Learning at Bangalore. Thank you all very much.
Thank you, ma'am.